Amen. All right, here in James chapter number 1, I want you to, let's focus in verse number 5. We'll begin James chapter number 1. Draw your attention to verse number 5 is where we'll begin. The Bible reads, "If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord." Verse 8 I want to focus on, and where I derive the title of my sermon this evening. It says this: a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. I'm going to be preaching this evening on the subject of being double-minded. Being double-minded. The object here, of course, is speaking about a double-minded man. I want you to draw your attention here at the very end of the verse. It says this: a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. So notice we're given a description of the subject, is what I meant to say earlier. The subject of what is being spoken of, which is a double-minded man. And it says that he is unstable in all his ways. Now, Christians are commanded to be the exact opposite. Christians are commanded to be stable. I want you to turn in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter number 15. 1 Corinthians chapter number 15. 1 Corinthians chapter number 15. Now, the reason being is because we have the truth. Christians have the truth. We have the truth in God's Word. We have God's Word, and God's Word is oftentimes likened unto a rock. And what is a rock? A rock is something that is stable. A rock is oftentimes also referred to as a foundation. I'm going to read to you from Matthew chapter number 7, verse number 24. This is Jesus speaking. He says this: "Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine," so Jesus' words, "and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock." Then it says this: "And everyone that heareth these sayings of mine, and doeth them not, shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it." Notice there's a very similar description that was given there when it speaks about the man that built his house upon the sand, and then also the man who is tossed to and fro. He's like a wave of the sea, just tossed to and fro. It's a very similar description that are given to about the two. But notice that he says that a man that hears his words, if there's a man that would hear Jesus' words and he were to do those words, he were to actually put those words into action, we can liken this unto salvation. What do you have to do to be saved? To believe, right? If you were to do that, that would be like you were building your house upon a rock. So that could be an application of it, right? Salvation's permanent. Once you're saved, you're always saved. You're upon the rock. You never have to worry about that again, right? But not only that, if Christ is teaching, if Jesus is teaching something in some other area, and you were to do that, wouldn't you also liken that unto a man that built his house upon the rock? His house upon a rock? Aren't Jesus's teachings, aren't they stable? Aren't they just as true today as they were when he taught them previously? Isn't, you know, and this is one of the things that is the major difference between the wisdom of the world and then the wisdom of God, which is, of course, God's Word. The wisdom of the world is always changing. The wisdom of the world, every year, every month, almost, just constantly, every era and every culture, even today on this earth, has different wisdom than maybe another culture. They have different wisdom than they had in the previous generation. They're always telling you this is the way in which you think that you should do this. This is wisdom, what they call wisdom, right? This is the correct way to perform this. This is the right way to live your life. This is the correct diet, whatever it may be. It's constantly changing. God's Word is never changing. God's Word never changes. That's because it's truth. Wouldn't you expect truth to remain the same? 2 plus 2 was 4, you know, the first day of creation. And 2 + 2 is still 4 today. Truth will remain the same forever. God, you know, God's word is truth, so it will never change. And God is his word. God has never changed. That's why, you know, the Bible talks about Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. Jesus is likened unto the rock. But also, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He also is His Word, therefore it makes perfect sense that His Word is never changing, because Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's never changing. Amen. So if we're going to base anything that we believe, if we are going to, you know, live our lives and try to find a path or a direction to how we should be living our lives and choices that we should make, don't you think you should build it upon a rock? Don't you think you should find a foundation that's never changing? A foundation that's going to remain the same today for 10, 15 years? If you were going to choose a, you know, an area to build your house, wouldn't you look at the soil and wouldn't you pour a foundation? Of course, because after it's constructed, after it's built and it's put together, the last thing you want is that foundation to change. Well, the foundation or the rock for a Christian is meant to be the Word of God. So wouldn't it make perfect sense that if our rock is never changing, if our rock remains the same today and will be the same at the end of our lives, from the point of your salvation to the day that you die, that rock is never going to change. Michaela, give me a drink of water, please. It's never going to change. So does it make sense for you to be a double-minded man? Let me ask you that question. It doesn't, does it? It would make sense for you to be a double-minded man, because if your choices, if your wisdom, if everything as far as your beliefs and your practice is based upon that rock, well, you should be single-minded. You should be going after everything that the Word of God tells you to do and to practice. I want you to look here in 1 Corinthians chapter number 15, and we see this instruction about remaining steadfast. Remaining steadfast. Look at 1 Corinthians 15. Look at the very end of the chapter, the last verse in the chapter. It's verse number 58. 1 Corinthians 15, 58 says this. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. So notice, this is a commandment. It's not a suggestion, it's a commandment. It says, therefore, my beloved brethren, speaking unto Christians, be ye steadfast. And then he gives you the definition of steadfast, unmovable. Doesn't that sound like being founded upon a rock? Doesn't that sound like what Jesus was explaining in Matthew chapter number 7? Notice the other man's the one that's moving. His house collapsed. There was a great fall. But what happened to the other guys? It was steadfast. It was unmovable. It was founded upon a rock. So as a Christian, your life, your Christianity, your spiritual walk should be steadfast. It should be unmovable. It shouldn't be changing daily. It shouldn't be changing from today to tomorrow. It shouldn't be changing down the years. It shouldn't be changing. Our doctrine shouldn't be constantly morphing and changing. We're going from one thing to the next, to the next, to the next. You know what you should do? You should find the truth, and you should found your beliefs on the truth, which is the rock, which is the Word of God. Why don't you go back to James chapter number 1. James chapter number 1. We're going to look there in James chapter number 1. We're going to spend a lot of our time in James chapter number 1. You may or may not have noticed this, but James chapter number 1, the major theme of James 1 is not being double-minded. Not being double-minded. That's why he introduces this concept in the very beginning. He introduces the theme of the book of James in the very beginning of the book, because he's getting ready to start addressing what he wants to speak to them about. There's different ways in which you can be double-minded. The first way is that you're just changing your beliefs constantly. The first way is that within your own mind, you are constantly being tossed to and fro. We would relate this unto specifically, like I alluded to a moment ago, maybe doctrine, just constantly changing your beliefs. We see this throughout the Bible being spoken of, a double-minded man in regards to excuse me, doctrine. Ephesians 4:14 says this, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine. By the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. Notice it's talking about beliefs here. It's talking about doctrine. And these are people that are being tossed to and fro. What are they? What are they? They're changing, aren't they? They're shifting. They're like sand. Are they founded upon a rock? Now, obviously, their doctrine is not founded upon the rock because they're moving from here to there. Does the rock move? No, it remains the same. So it's clear, they're not on the rock, are they? Their doctrine is changing from one day to the next. You see the exact same concept, almost the exact same wording in Hebrews chapter number 13, verse number 9. It says this, "Be not carried about with divers and strange doctrines." So divers is just different, right? "Divers and strange doctrines. For it is a good thing that the heart be established with grace." And it goes on, so forth and so forth. Notice the established, talking about not moving. To be established upon something is like being founded upon something. So number one, we need to, as far as our doctrine, we need to be settled on what we believe. We as a church, we as individuals, we don't need to be shifting our doctrine constantly to and fro. We don't need to be, you know, one day being a dispensationalist and then the next day not being a dispensationalist and then later on converting back to dispensationalism. We don't need to, you know, be believing in pre-trib, the pre-tribulation rapture, and then maybe you talk to me the next week and I'm like, "Brother, I'm pretty sure it's post-tribulation pre-wrath." And then I speak to you again later and I'm like, "You know what? I think it's just post-wrath." You know, and then I go back and then you speak to me another year later and I'm up here preaching a sermon on why the rapture is pre-tribulation. You know, we need to be founded on what we believe. We need to know what we believe. We need not to be tossed to and fro, just backwards and forwards. This is in regards to every area. This is in regards to all of our doctrine. We need to study to show ourselves approved. You say, "Man, well, there's some things that are difficult in the Bible." Then study. Amen. Then study. Figure out the truths of the book. Study it. Maybe you're not studying it enough because you don't love it enough. Maybe that's the reason why. Study the Word of God. Enjoy studying the Word of God. You know, study the Word of God and be hungry to figure out what those truths are. Don't you want to know what truth is? Don't you want to know what the Bible actually teaches on subjects so you can defend it, so you can have comfort in your soul to know, "Hey, I know what that subject says. I know what God wants me to do in that area. I know what's right about that doctrine." And not only that, so that you're not tossed to and fro. And you know what? How those people are being tossed to and fro? It says by the sleight of men. When you're not sure what the Bible teaches on a subject, do you know what's going to happen? Man can just come in and deceive you because you're so easily swayed because you're not founded upon the Word of God. The Word of God is a rock. So we need to know what we believe in every area and on every subject. The King James Bible, we need to be founded upon. Now, that is the rock, right? It's the Word of God. I believe that this is the rock. I don't believe that the NIV, both of them cannot be the rock because they're different. Right. Both of them, the ESV, the NIV, just pick one. They're all the same rock. No. This is the rock right here. Amen. The King James Version of the Bible. They're not the same, my friend. Right. All of those Bible versions, they all would say, "Hey, if you were to ask someone in their camp, they would all say, hey, that's a good version, that's a good version." And it's, of course, if they're, you know, purporting one of the specific versions, they'd say, "Well, this is the best version, right?" But they would look at the other ones and say, "They're all pretty good." Not a King James onlyist. We would say that, and that's truth right there. This is the rock, and the other ones, that's all the sand. You know why? Because they're changing constantly. They come out with a new one, and they got a new translation. They got a new interpretation of a new passage. It's different. A passage will teach you something entirely different than the last version did. That's not the rock, my friend. That is not the Word of God. That is not the foundation. We need something that's never changing. We need something that stays the same all the time. So you know what you need to do? You need to be solid on the King James Bible issue. You need to know this is the Word of God, and you cannot sway me away from it. If we talk about any particular doctrines, hey, the Godhead, you need to know what the Bible teaches on the Godhead. You need to not, you know, in 6 months be, you know, shifting your position entirely on what you believe about the Godhead. You need to not be shifting your position after, you know, after. So here's the thing. You know, everyone in this building would probably say at one time, I would have subscribed to in some way the pre-tribulation rapture, right? You know, I may have not have been confident in the position, but if you would have asked me, there was definitely a time when I would have just said, "Hey, yeah, I'm pre-trib." Yeah, it's pre-tribulation rapture, right? I would have just told you that, right? But there was a time when I was confronted with the truths of what the Bible taught. And then I realized that what I believed was not what the Bible taught. You know what I did? I changed at that moment. Now, change in that particular circumstance was a good thing. It was not a bad thing. So don't misunderstand me to say, hey, wherever I'm at, I just need to stay there because you said I need to be like a rock. I need to be unchanging. If you're wrong, you need to change because you need to move to the rock. I'm saying once you find out the truth and you get on the rock, don't leave it. And not only that, if you are not on the rock and you're not sure if you're on the rock and you're not even sure where the rock is, then you need to, as far as a teaching in the Bible, then you need to study it out and then you need to get on the rock. You need to figure that out. So we need to not be a double-minded man. So where does it begin? Well, it begins with the rock. That's where it begins. How do we, step one, how do we prevent from being a double-minded man? You need to find something that's unchanging so that you know in your mind, hey, this is where I need to be. You need single-mindedness? Well, you need to find what's the truth. You don't want to be single-minded in error, do you? No, you want to be single-minded with truth. So step one is, hey, I need to find what the truth is. I need to find what I need to believe and what the Bible teaches in this area, and it starts with the rock itself. Not only that, point number two, and this is where we're going to stay for the day, or for the evening, James chapter number one. Go back to James chapter number one, as I said. The theme is introduced in the very beginning of the book here, the book of James, of double-mindedness. It's actually the same theme from beginning to end, and it's about hypocrisy. It's about a person that is speaking the truth, that's saying all the right things, that has the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ, but then they're not actually putting it into practice. That's also another way in which you can be a double-minded man. And that's actually the theme of the book of James, and this is where we would find it very relevant, of course, to us today. Everyone here in our church is pretty strong practicing Christians. We attend church all the time, right? I can't miss it. I'm not. It's not possible for me. Now, here's the thing. We read our Bibles all the time, right? There's other areas of our Christianity that we have this in a routine. We pray all the time, right? We pray on a daily basis multiple times. We read our Bibles every day. We go soul winning weekly, most of us multiple times, right? These are just the practices of a Christian, of what I would say would be a strong Christian, right? Would be a strong Christian. It's the things that we're commanded to do, and we're doing them on a routine basis. That's how I would define in this case, in these terms, a person that would be a seasoned Christian, if you will. Now, I'm speaking outside of certain characters and things like that. Just humor me for a second. This is a Christian that's living the life of a Christian, of what they're commanded, okay? I would say that everyone in here falls into that category, So the book of James is written to Christians who are striving to live the life of a Christian, what they're commanded to be doing. And there's a major warning that is given to them repeatedly of not being a hypocrite, of not being double-minded, of not saying one thing and then doing something different. Not only being hearers of the word, but doers also. Because you're just deceiving your own selves. We're going to look at that right now. Look back at James chapter number 1, verse number 5. We're going to look at it again, what we read previously. And then we'll continue this same train of thought, this same continuity through the book of James. Look at James 1, verse 5. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. Now, that's a pretty strong warning that, hey, I'm not going to answer any of your prayers if you're a double-minded man. If you're a double-minded man, if your faith is wavering, Don't let him think that he's going to get anything from me. That's what God is saying. It says in the following verse, a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. So in all his ways. Then it goes on, verse 9, let the brother of low degree rejoice in that he is exalted. Here in verses 10 through really through 11, we see also another theme. These things are coupled together throughout the book of James, and it is the subject of envy. It is the subject of rich versus poor. It's the subject of riches in and of itself. It comes up in almost every single chapter in the book of James. So you see that there in verses 10 through roughly, like I said, 11. Then it goes on talking about lust and temptation there in those next couple of verses. And I want to pick up with you in verse 16 where he starts addressing the issue again. So he kind of sidestepped, but he kept with the theme there in those few verses. Look at verse 16. It says this. Do not err, my beloved brethren. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Now notice what he said. With whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. What is he saying? That God is consistent. That's what he's saying. It's the same subject. He's talking about a continuity in God's character, that he is unchanging. A double-minded man would be someone that there is variableness. It varies. They change from time to time. This is a continual theme we're going to see through. We're going to be going through the book of James. So then he goes on, verse number 18 there, to speak of how we were begotten by the Word of God. So you must have the Word of God in order to be saved. Go to verse 19. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. For the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. Wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the ingrafted word, which is able to save your souls. Now, he's speaking already to saved, born-again Christians. When he says save your souls, I do not believe that this is speaking about spiritual salvation, and I'm going to show you why throughout the book of James. Now, these people are already saved, number one. I think that is a step, number one, to help you understand that this is not talking about salvation right now. Oftentimes, the word soul in the Bible just speaks to the core of the person. It speaks of however many souls went down into Egypt when it's Jacob and his brethren and Israel and them go, right? It was like 70 souls went down into Egypt. So it's just referring to their person, to who they are. It's just a way to refer to the core of their being, to express the value of their worth. So we see there, which is able to, excuse me, save your souls. Verse 22, but be ye doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. What you have here is the description again of an unstable man, which would also be a double-minded man. It would be someone that is a hearer of the word. When the Bible says hear, it's like they're listening. It's someone that's not rejecting what you're saying. They're hearing you. They're receiving what you're saying, but then they're not putting it into practice. That is an example of what we would call a hypocrite, right? They're acting like they believe it. They're acting like, hey, you should do it. Maybe they're even speaking it to other people, but then they're not putting it into practice themselves. It would be a hypocrite, also known as a double-minded man. Look at verse 23. For if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. For he beholdeth himself and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso, watch this, looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein. What's that speaking about? It's talking about consistency. That's talking about there not being variableness. That's talking about there being a person that's not being a hypocrite, or that's not a double-minded man. He's continuing. He's steadfast. He's unmovable. He's founded upon a rock. He's stable. It says, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed. Then it goes on in verse 26 and 27 to speak about a hypocrite. If any man among you seem to be a religious and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is in vain. I want you to keep that in mind as well. This is also a theme throughout the book of James. Bridling your tongue. Bridling your tongue. This is talking about a person that just can't control the things that they speak. That they would be a person that would maybe be a backbiter. Someone that is maybe railing on another person. It's saying that if a person here seems to be religious, so the person he's talking about who's hearing the word, do they seem to be religious? Do they claim to be religious? Are they saying that they're a Christian? Are they saying, now I'm not talking about salvation, I'm talking about living the life of Christ, right? A disciple of Christ. Are they claiming these things? Yes. But then what does it say? It says, if he doesn't bridle his own tongue, he bridleth not his tongue, It says, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is in vain. What is it? It's speaking about a man that is a hypocrite. It's speaking about a man that is double-minded, a man that is unstable. He goes on to explain to you in verse number 27 what pure religion is. If you want the definition of religion, it's found actually in verse number 27. You can read that later after services. Chapter number 2, I want to move on into chapter number 2. We're going to get into something that is of strong controversy in just a moment as far as the gospel of grace. Most people, when they go to attack the true gospel, when they attack eternal security, when they attack salvation by faith with no works involved at all, normally they're going to take you. If they know what they're talking about, they'll take you to James chapter number 2. I'm going to end this sermon and with this same theme, which is the theme of the book of James, I'm going to explain to you the interpretation within context of the book of James of James chapter number 2 that is oftentimes misunderstood by people. I want you to pick up there in James chapter number 2, verse number 1. I want you to notice the same exact theme. Verse number 1, my brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with respect of persons. You know what you have there? A double-minded man. You have a man that's saying one thing, but he's not doing what he's supposed to be doing. He claims himself to be religious, doesn't he? But he's not actually putting it into practice, right? What you have here is, I want to put something into your mind for just a moment. You have faith without works. That's what you have in verse number 1. Chapter number 2, verse number 1. It is the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ with respect of persons. So it's without good works, if you will. It's faith without works is what we have in chapter number 2, verse number 1. But notice the continuity of thought. He's still speaking to a hypocrite. He's speaking to a disobedient Christian, someone who's coming to church, they're religious, but they're not doing the work. They're unstable. They're a double-minded man. Look at verse number 2. For if there come unto your assembly a man with a gold ring. I have to point this out just because this has been talked about so much. Notice, even when he's writing to the strangers scattered abroad, what does he say to them? If there come unto your what? Assembly. What is that referring to? Church. So it doesn't matter. You want to find whatever book you want. There's a church there. There are people gathering together, and they're meeting as a congregation. If they're coming unto your assembly, he's talking about they're coming unto your congregation, or they're coming unto your church. If they're coming to your assembly, a man with a gold ring in goodly apparel, and they're coming also a poor man in vile raiment. What was the other theme I mentioned a moment ago? Rich versus poor. Envying, right? Look at what it says next. And ye have respect to him that weareth the gay clothing, and say unto him, sit thou here in a good place, and say to the poor, stand thou there, or sit under my footstool. Watch this. Are ye not then partial in yourselves? What's partial? It's like variableness. It's like being double-minded. It's like being unstable. That's what a person that is a respecter of persons is. They are an unstable person. They don't have something that they are founded upon, a moral that they are founded upon. It's not based upon a moral standard. They're just being tossed to and fro based upon, oh, this guy's rich, this guy's poor. That is the concept of being a respecter of persons. It's very unstable. Look at what it says in verse number 5. Hearken, my beloved brethren, hath not God chosen the poor of this world, rich in faith, and heirs of the kingdom which he hath promised to them that love him? But ye have despised the poor. Do not rich men oppress you and draw you before the judgment seats? Do not they blaspheme that worthy name by the which ye are called? If ye fulfill the royal law according to Scripture, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Ye do well. Now, Christianity today, neo-Christianity, has basically become, and I use that because I'm about to talk about neo-conservatives. They, you know, a lot of Christians today are Republicans first, and then they're Christians second, or they're Christians next. They put their priorities into their politics, and that's what's the most important thing to them. And oftentimes their political platform, whereof they subscribe to, will decide what they believe when it comes to the Bible on so many different subjects. The Republicans are known for being wealthy. The Republicans are known for having a lot of wealth. That is true. I mean, politicians in general have a lot of wealth, but oftentimes they're known for having a lot of wealth. And Oftentimes when you speak to an independent fundamental Baptist pastor, if he picks one platform or the other, which one does he subscribe to? Republican, all the time, doesn't he? They're always Republican. You know what they're always trying to do? Constantly is just defend the rich. Here's the thing. Rich people throughout the Bible from beginning to end, you can like this or lump it, they're wicked. Amen. They're wicked people. That's what. Now, I'm not saying every last one of them, but in general, the Bible talks about the rich being wicked. The Bible will specifically just categorize the rich as being wicked many, many times. So, and the reason being is because the love of money is the root of all evil. And most people, when they have wealth, they aren't disciplined enough to be able to curb the lust for more wealth. Oftentimes, they can't control themselves, you know, because when you have a lot of money and you have a lot of wealth, you got it by some means or through some source, right? Well, whatever that source is, people will often keep going back to that. They'll keep trying to go back to that source just to get more because the heart of man is never satisfied. So oftentimes when man becomes rich, he becomes very wicked. And that's just a fact of what the Bible teaches. So don't get caught up into these teachings of the world, of what the conservative platform and what they will teach, you know, as far as, the rich versus the poor and those and along those lines. You know, the rich oftentimes in the Bible are very wicked people, according to the Bible. That's what the Bible teaches. Just wanted to throw that in there. But look at verse 8. If ye fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself, ye do well. But if ye have respect to persons, ye commit sin and are convinced of the law as transgressors. For whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, he is guilty of all. For he that said, do not commit adultery, said also, do not kill. Now if thou commit no adultery, yet if thou kill, thou art become a transgressor of the law. So speak ye, and so do as they that shall be judged by the law of liberty. Look at verse 13. For he shall have judgment without mercy that hath showed no mercy, and mercy rejoiceth against judgment. So what is this verse right here talking about? It's talking about if you are not merciful to others, if you do not love your neighbor, if a poor man comes into your assembly and you are partial in yourselves and you are treating him poorly because you are being a biased person, a respecter of persons, that God is going to judge you without mercy because you yourself didn't show mercy, right? And that's how God is going to judge you. So it's referring specifically to the judgment of God. Now, I want you to look at the very next verse, because right here we get into the passage that actually speaks of, you know, faith without works. The famous passage that many people will try to take and to twist and to abuse, and what they're doing, like many times false teachers do, they're taking it out of context. So with what we just read in mind, it's speaking about judging you, right? Judging the brethren, judging a Christian, if someone comes to the assembly and you don't show mercy on them, it's saying that God will not have mercy on you in judgment, correct? Look at the very next verse. What doth it profit, my brethren, though a man say he hath faith and have not works, can faith save him? We haven't changed subjects. Verse number one was talking about faith without works. Verse number one was talking about a double-minded man. And what would we say about a man that says he has faith, but he doesn't have works? It would be a man that seems to be religious. It would be an unstable man. It would be a double-minded man. It would be a man that, wherein there is variableness, right? So that's point number one of what we're speaking of. The theme hasn't changed. But not only that, it says this. Can faith save him? Save him from what? What is the context? Judgment. Save him from judgment of God. Now, proof of that this is speaking of physical judgment, is a simple search throughout the book of James itself into what the word save in the book of James means. I want you to turn with me to James chapter number 5. Go back to the last chapter, James chapter number 5, verse number 15. It says this, and the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. Is that talking about saving him from hell, or is that a physical salvation? Okay, so looking at this verse alone, what does the word save mean in the book of James? physical salvation. Look at verse number 20. Let him know that he which converteth the sinner from the error of his way shall save a soul from death and shall hide a multitude of sins. What is this talking about? It's talking about if one of you do err from the truth, one of the brethren, if you look at verse 19, brethren, if any of you do err from the truth, and it says, and one convert him. It's talking about you're going to save a soul from death. Why? Because God will punish him. That's why. Because he would be, even just inherently living a life of sin brings death in the first place. But God will punish his children. He could save him from death from his children. But even stronger than that, to prove this without a shadow of a doubt, two chapters later, the same exact subject is spoken of, and it even tells you that it's talking about the judge, right? That is who it spoke of in James 2. It's talking about a judgment. Who is it speaking of judging? God. And then it was talking about him not having mercy. Look at James 4. Look at James chapter number 4. Let's look at verse number 11 first. Speak not evil one of another, brethren. He that speaketh evil of his brother and judgeth his brother speaketh evil of the law and judgeth the law. But if thou judge the law, thou art not a doer of the law, but a judge. Then he says this, there is one lawgiver who is able to save and to destroy. Now, who's the lawgiver? It's God, right? That's who the judge is, right? Then he goes on to say, who art thou that judgest another? Keep reading. Go to now, ye that say, today or tomorrow we will go into such a city and continue there a year and buy and sell and get gain. Watch what he says next. Whereas ye know not what shall be on the morrow, for what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. Verse 15, for that ye ought to say, if the Lord will, we shall live and do this or that. So notice there in verse number 12, it says there is one lawgiver who is able to save and to destroy. Then he goes on to detail what he's talking about if God were to destroy you. And what is it? What is your life? It is even a vapor. So in context, in James chapter number 4, when it's speaking of being saved or being destroyed, two verses later, he utters the words, what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. He's speaking about God judging you. Every time we see the word saved used in the book of James, every single time. Obviously, James chapter number 5, verse number 15, the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and he shall raise him up, physical. We look at verse 20, you shall, brethren, and then it says, shall save a soul from death, physical. We look at James chapter number 1, there in verse number, what was it, verse number 21 at the end, while he's speaking to brethren that their souls are already saved as far as their spiritual salvation. So soul here is, of course, speaking about the person itself and can be speaking about their life. It says, which is able, the word of God, which is able to save your souls. And he's talking about them receiving it to save them from what? From judgment, from the lawgiver. In James chapter number 2, go back to James chapter number 2. In context, it is talking about being judged by God. It is talking about God having mercy upon us and God not judging us without mercy. Then he asks the question in verse 14, what doth it profit, my brethren, though a man say he hath faith and have not works, can faith save him? The definition of the word saved throughout the book of James is physical salvation, every single time. In context here in James 2, further proving that, is he is talking about a Christian being judged by God. We keep reading down through here. Look at the same theme as continued in verse 15. If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, depart in peace, be ye warmed and filled, notwithstanding ye give them not those things which are needful to the body, what doth it profit? You know what you have here? A man's religion that is in vain. You have a person saying one thing. He's a hearer of the word, but he's not a doer of the work, right? He's not actually doing what he was commanded to do. Is this man doing the sayings like what Jesus said in Matthew chapter number 7? He said, a man that heareth my words and doeth them, I will liken him unto a man that built his house upon a rock. No, it's the exact opposite. He hears the word, but then he's not doing it. He's following Jesus around, but he's not actually putting the things that he's telling him into practice. Do you know what we have here is you have a double-minded man. You have someone hearing the things, knowing what they should do, but not actually practicing them. He's saying to him, depart in peace, be ye warmed and filled. It says, notwithstanding, ye give them not those things which are needful to the body. What doth it profit? Then he says in verse 17, even so faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone. Now, what does that mean? It means that faith that is dead, it's not alive because it's not helping people. If your faith was alive, there would be works there. That's what that is referring to. Now, faith that is living is faith that you can see that I'm living out, that I'm acting out, that I'm actually doing it. You can look at me and see my faith. That would be faith that is alive. Man, his faith is really alive. He's really doing a lot. Do you want to know dead faith? Dead faith would be a person that believes in Jesus, that's sitting on their butt and doing nothing for God. Dead faith would be a person that's not helping the poor, a person that's not coming to church, a person that's not reading their Bible. They believe, but they're not doing any work. That's dead faith. That's what that's talking about. And then when it asks the question there, what doth it profit? It's talking about that man. What doth it profit? What does your faith profit someone else? What does your faith profit this man that needs to be warmed and filled? If you just say to him, be warmed and filled, what does it profit? It profits him nothing. It's speaking about how your faith affects other people. If your faith is alive, then you can see it. You're using it. It's moving. What is something that's dead? It's not moving. It's not alive. It's not doing anything. But faith that is alive is faith that's being lived out. Now, does that mean that people that, you know, have faith, but they're not doing works, does that mean that they're not saved? No, faith alone is what saves you. But guess what? They're not helping people. And guess what? When someone needs help, you know what's going to happen? When they need help, God's not going to show them mercy. When it's time, maybe they sin against God and they didn't show mercy to other people, well, he's not going to show them mercy. That's in context, my friend, of what it says. Amen. That it clearly tells you in verse number 13, for he shall have judgment without mercy that has showed no mercy, and mercy rejoiceth against judgment, speaking to a Christian. That's the context. Now, you could try to make this say something else, but that's, you're doing the same thing that a lordship salvationist is doing if you're ripping it out of context. You may have good intentions to try to, you know, to try to make this to be in congruence with the gospel of grace, but that's not the true teaching. The true teaching is that the judge is going to judge you, and how are you going to be saved physically? That's the definition of saved in the book of James, from God, because he's the lawgiver when he decides to judge you. What is your life? It is even a vapor. And then you go on to read through it. It's talking how verse 22, it speaks about Abraham. And seest thou how faith wrought with his works, and by works was faith made perfect. That's a theme of the book of James. James chapter number 1, the man that's double-minded is a man that's not perfect. It says in James 1 verse 4, but let patience have her perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. That's the same context, the same theme from beginning to end. It's speaking about the exact same man, and nothing has changed. It's talking about a man having faith and also having works. It's talking about a man having faith but then pushing on. You know, the first step to Christianity is putting your faith in Christ. But that's the first step. You're a babe in Christ now. Amen. There's more. Amen. And you know what happens next? Actually having works. Actually, that's the theme of all of Paul's letters. If you look at them, they start off super doctrinal. And what they do is he's teaching like a lot of head knowledge. But you get to Hebrews and there's a major shift. And you start seeing the word endure. You start seeing the word patience, right? You start seeing these words repeatedly. You start hearing him where he's more so prodding people to do works. Then you move on from Hebrews, right? And what's the next book after Hebrews? James. Do you know what it starts talking about in the very beginning? Do works. 1 John. Do you know what a major theme of 1 John is? Works. Doing works. Repeatedly talks about doing works. That's how it's set up. Doctrine is the first step, getting head knowledge. Being just founded upon the rock as far as salvation. Receiving the word, hey, I believe in Jesus. Now you have faith, but guess what? Don't be a double-minded man. Actually, start having works. Actually, don't let your religion be in vain. Actually, start having, putting your faith to practice and have living faith. We see the same concept, though. I want you to look at James chapter number 3 just to further prove that the judgment is coming to a Christian. My brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. What does that mean? That's talking about that you are held accountable. You are held accountable, for the things that you know, for the things that you have been taught. A person, how does the verse go when it talks about, a man that has been given much, of him shall much be required, the Bible talks about, right? So a Christian that is actually assembling, that's learning all these things, they're going to be judged stronger. They're going to be judged, on a higher level than someone that doesn't know that much, than a person maybe that just believed, right? Not only that, you could even apply this in this context as well. When the word condemnation comes up in regards to Christians, do you know what other word comes up? Judgment in 1 Corinthians chapter number 11. The Bible talks about how we will not be condemned with the world, that we are judged so that we're not condemned with the world. And it's talking about the judgment on this earth. Now, you know what's funny is that he's saying that those that are not saved are not judged, but we are judged. Doesn't that make sense? The greater condemnation, they're not going to receive a punishment. If we're speaking in context of the punishment on this earth, but we are going to receive a punishment, speaking of maybe a person that's not saved. So chapter number 3, we're going to see the same concept that's going through here. We'll see the tongue being brought up a lot, just like we saw a man spoken of that's not bridling his tongue. That is spoken of in verse number, let's begin. I don't want to begin in verse number 2. Let's begin in verse number 5. It says, even so the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body and setteth on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire of hell. Skip down. Look what it says in verse number 9. I want you to notice what he starts speaking about here. Therewith bless we God, even the Father. And then it says this, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. What does that sound like? It sounds like a double-minded man, doesn't it? Notice how he's doing one thing and then he's doing another thing. These things are contrary. Like it talks about the spirit and the flesh, the one to the other, right? Blessing God and then cursing man. These things are contrary to one another. If a man was doing both of these, wouldn't you say, hey, that's a double-minded man? Same concept going through here. It goes on to speak of the same subject. Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not so to be. Doth the fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? Skip down with me to, to verse 16. For where envying and strife is, there is confusion in every evil work. We see envy being brought up again, talking about, notice what they were doing. They were treating a man that has money better. Why would you do that? Because you're a covetous or envious person, right? Not only that, it's talking about strife. Here it's talking about how the tongue is what kindles strife. So these are two problems that this assembly obviously has. Envying, and they care about money. It keeps bringing up the same theme. Maybe he felt like this is something that he needed to warn them of. And strife is also brought up because he keeps speaking about the tongue. But not only that, look at verse 17. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits. These are all areas in which they are lacking. They didn't have mercy. And then it says this, without partiality. What were they doing before? They were being partial in themselves. Not only that, it says this, and without hypocrisy. What is that? That's a double-minded man. This is the same issue that they keep having. Look at chapter number 4 now. Look at chapter number 4, further proving that they're having issues with envy. It says in verse number 1, we'll just begin in chapter number 4, verse 1, from whence come wars and fightings among you? Come they not hence, even of your lusts that war in your members? Verse 2, ye lust and have not, ye kill and desire to have, and cannot obtain. Ye fight in war, yet ye have not, because ye ask not. What was he talking about in James chapter number 1? You know, let him ask of God, who giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not. He said, you have not because you ask not. Same theme. Look at verse 4. Ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be the friend of the world is the enemy of God. Again, we see double-mindedness mentioned once more. This is talking about a person that is living in the world or being a friend of the world. What is he talking about? He's talking about the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the pride of life. He says it's not of the Father, but it's of the world in 1 John, right? It's talking about it, that right before that says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. What's it talking about? Envying the things of the world. What are they doing? They're envying the things of the world. A sign of a double-minded man oftentimes, and there are people that I have looked back after understanding the book of James, and every one of them were a covetous person. People that were very double-minded. People that were shifting from Bible to Bible. A person specifically. Constantly was going to a different Bible. He always had some new phase that he was going through in his life. He always had some new idea or something like that constantly that he wanted to try or whatever it was. And he never settled on anything. There's nothing wrong with trying new things when you're settling down in your life. But if you grow to 50 and 60 years old and you're still trying out all these different ideas and you still don't know what the Word of God is and you're some sort of leader in a church, there's a problem, my friend. You're a double-minded man. Normally, you look at those type of people, they're very covetous people. They're very envious of the world. They're living this double life. They're walking in the flesh. But they're speaking like they're you know, wanting to live in the Spirit, like they're living in the Spirit. That man's religion is in vain. We see here is speaking about envying, and it's speaking about a double-minded man. It's a person that is the friendship of the world. It's like what Jesus said as well when he spoke about how no man can serve two masters. He will either love the one and hate the other, or he'll despise the one and hold to the other, something along those lines. You cannot serve God and who? Mammon. What is that referring to? Money. The world. You know, when people are normally double-minded, they're split in their decisions. It's the lust of the world, of their flesh. Because you have the Spirit in the flesh, you're going to be double-minded to some degree, right? You're going to be struggling at least to some degree with trying to shut the flesh up. But when you see a person that is just constantly inconsistent and unstable, and they're shifting back and forth, and it's just obvious to the world that they're just constantly living, just obvious to you, that is, that they're constantly just going back and forth. They're tossed to and fro, and it's obvious. We see that kind of person, it's because they're walking the flesh constantly. That's what it is. They're walking in the flesh, and they're being pulled by the flesh all the time. They have the Spirit there, but the flesh, the lust of the world is always bringing them back. You know what it is? It's covetousness. It's envying. It's wanting the things of this world. Notice what it says after this also. Verse number 5, do you think that the Scripture saith in vain, the Spirit that dwelleth in us lusteth to envy, but he giveth more grace? Wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. Submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Watch this, pay attention. Speaking about a covetous, worldly person, it says, draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. We didn't change themes. It's the same theme from beginning to end. It's speaking about one a particular type of person. It's talking about a double-minded man. You know what we get here is we get the characteristics of a double-minded man. Not only that, you know what you get in this book? You get the warnings that are given to a double-minded man. You get the warnings that are given to a person that is a covetous person, a person that is, you know, walking in the flesh. You know what they're oftentimes doing is they're oftentimes not helping other people. You know why? Because they're concerned about themselves. You look at, just pick in your mind any random person that's like the epitome, the epitome. I don't know why I just thought of that. You guys know what I'm talking about. The epitome of a covetous person. And those particular people, they're super selfish, aren't they? They're extremely selfish. Very covetous, envious people that are just obsessed with the rich and they are just wanting to be rich so bad, they're very self-centered people, always. And you know what those type of people do? They don't help the poor. If there's a man that's saved that has that in his heart and he's trying to serve both masters and he's loving the world, he's a double-minded man. And we have the warnings that are given to a man that does that, because it will lead you down that same path. It'll lead you down that same path of where you'll start just being consumed with yourself, where you're just wavering back and forth constantly. You want to do what's right, but you're just walking in the flesh constantly. Because your strong urges and your lusts and your envy are just keep pulling you away. That's why you're going back and forth and back and forth. Because you don't have control. Your lust is what's driving you here and there and back and forth. He's like a wave that's driven with the seas, tossed back and forth, to and fro, like it says, right? You're just driven back and forth. That's because they're not walking in the Spirit. And what will happen is you'll become a very self-centered person. And when you're not fulfilling, like it says, the royal law, if you're not loving your neighbor, now, of course, we're all going to sin to some degree, right? None of us are going to be perfect. None of us, like I said, even to some degree, we're going to be what we would all agree. None of us have the flesh perfectly in check. It's like, my flesh hasn't made a decision in 30 years, brother. That doesn't happen, right? That doesn't happen. I'm talking about what the Bible's defining as a double-minded man here. I'm talking about all these characteristics of a double-minded man. And you know what? It probably wasn't exactly what you thought that it was. But where we find that phrase, double-minded man, there's a theme that's carried throughout it. You know what we find? Envy. We find covetousness. We find, a selfish, self-centered person. We find a man that is a respecter of persons. Why? Because because he's envious. We find a man that cannot control his tongue. A man who says that he's doing all the right things, but he's not. We find a hypocrite. We find this man in the assembly. And he's right. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. Yeah, we find the man in the assembly, don't we? We find him in church, right? So you know what that means? All of us need to be guard against this. We need to guard against this in our hearts. This is a Christian that's doing this, right? This is a Christian man that could fall into this category. So you know what you need to do? You need to walk in the Spirit. You need to not fulfill the lust of the flesh. What you need to do is you need to look out for these things in your life too. Therefore, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall. You need to look out for covetousness. You need to look out for envy. You need to look out for respecter of persons. You need to look out for not bridling your tongue. You need to look out for being a selfish person. You need to look out for not treating maybe the poor. God has a heart. I don't know if you guys remember, I preached a sermon about that. It's all throughout the Bible. God has a heart for the poor. God cares for the afflicted and the widows and those that are oppressed. And you want to talk about God not showing mercy to you when he judges you? Treat the poor bad. Treat the afflicted bad. Treat those, I'm not talking about some just rotten to the core homeless guy who's out there molesting people. A lot of the homeless are terrible people. Not every last one of them is like a wicked reprobate, but a lot of them are disgustingly evil people. I'm talking about good-hearted poor people that are working. They're trying to earn a living, and you had an opportunity in your life to help them in whatever way you couldn't, and you were like, hey man, I'm too busy. I got to get to work. I got to make some money. You know what God will do? He'll judge you and he won't have mercy. So you know, you have the warning there given to the double-minded man. What's the theme of the book of James? It's written to the audience of being. And what is, we find this, let's summarize it this way. We find, number one, the characteristics of a double-minded man. We see inside the mind of a double-minded man. We see the identifiers of a double-minded man. And what were they? Envy, covetousness, self-centered, and he can't control his tongue. Keep those things in your mind. And if you start to become that double-minded man, because it's written, as I said, to a man in the assembly. If you start to see those things, you better make sure you put that flesh in check. You better make sure that you don't become that double-minded man. Because you know what it says? Don't let him think that he'll receive anything of the Lord. God will shut up heaven as far as the prayers. He will not, your prayer won't make it further than the ceiling, like I've heard people say. God will no longer answer any of your prayers. That's scary. You want to get to a state of where Saul was, where God would not hear him? We don't want to be like that, of course. Don't become the double-minded man. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we thank you, dear Lord, for the warnings. We thank you for just the clear description.